remember me? Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire's here with her coffee. Come on in and grab yourself a cup. We're going to talk about YouTube and YouTubers and whatever else springs to mind. Let's start out today with a resurrection of sorts. One of my earliest series on YouTube was called Mixed Nuts, and it was my view of the elected officials in America who are leading us down the long, slow, winding path to abject decrepitude. Let's start out today by highlighting the mighty senators of the state of Oklahoma, Jim Inhofe and Tom Coburn. Not to put too fine a point on it, these two guys are bastards. Last year, they both voted against federal aid to the victims of Hurricane Sandy.
You said that the request for funding was a slush fund.
But you can rest assured that as soon as a giant tornado hit Oklahoma City, they were running around to Washington with their begging bowls.
That was totally different.
Yeah, that's completely different. First of all, most of those people don't vote for your party. And second of all, you were pissed off at New Jersey Governor Chris Christie for treating President Obama with common courtesy and the respect due a president. Perhaps the hypocrisy is particularly galling because over the years, the august senators from Oklahoma have done nothing but carp and criticize the Federal Emergency Management Agency and cut their budget every chance they've had an opportunity to do so. Now, lest I be accused of liberal bias, my next highlight isn't a prairie hayseed and prostitute for the climate change denying petrochemical industry.
Why do you, Sheldon Whitehouse, Democrat of Rhode Island, care if we Republicans run off the climate cliff like a bunch of proverbial lemmings, when cyclones tear up Oklahoma, and hurricanes swamp Alabama, and wildfires scorch Texas? You come to us, the rest of the country, for billions of dollars to recover.
Admittedly, White House is making a semi-valid point in that climate change models predict that we'll have more frequent violent weather events in the future. But you cannot correlate particular weather events with climate change. There's a reason Oklahoma is known as Tornado Alley. And in terms of hurricanes, I think the worst hurricanes America has ever experienced in terms of loss of human life were the Galveston hurricane of 1900 and Hurricane Camille of 1969, I believe. Well, let's end this segment with a celebration of the career of Michelle Bachmann, who has decided not to run for re-election. Now, lest you start celebrating, just reflect that her district kept re-electing her, so they'll probably elect someone just as vacuous, if not as loquacious.
And I don't know how much God has to do to get the attention of the politicians. We've had an earthquake, we've had a hurricane. He said, are you going to start listening to me here?
Isn't it remarkable how the mind of God coincides perfectly with the personal obsessions of Michelle Bachmann? Now then, what would Coffee with Claire be without a mention of Young Earth Creationists? And the following segment highlights one of their deepest secrets. Was Philip Henry Goss, and what was the Omphalos hypothesis? Goss was a noted mid-19th century English naturalist, an expert in shallow marine invertebrates, and he was also a lay preacher. Goss was deeply disturbed by modern science of his day turning away from biblical literalism and the idea that the earth was only a few thousand years old. Goss was particularly interested in counteracting the influence of Charles Lyell and his popularization of the concept of uniformitarianism. I suspect that Goss was also particularly upset when noted naturalists and high Anglican officials like William Buckland and Adam Sedgwick turned away from young earth creationism and embraced the idea that the earth was of great antiquity. About a year before Charles Darwin published Origin of the Species, Goss published his book on phallus, which attempted to shove the square peg of young earth creationism into the round hole of reality. Essentially, Goss's argument was that despite the fact that the geologic record seemed to indicate a long and complex geologic history, it was in fact a massive deceit by the Creator. It will probably not surprise you that Goss's book was met with universal derision, and his reputation never quite recovered. Now, here is my point. Although modern young earth creationists would vehemently deny that they accept the omphalos argument, if one looks at the oldest, most complex rocks on the planet, the metamorphic and igneous rocks that form the bases of all continents, then by implication, they simply must accept the omphalos argument. The mineralogy and the structures of these rocks, not to mention the radiometric dates, which show that they're billions of years old, indicate a long and complex geologic history, but young earth creationists must maintain that the rocks were created within the last few thousand years. So, by implication, God created them to look as if they had had a long, complex geologic history. Given the previous segment on American politicians, you may consider the next portion of our video completely unnecessary, but we're going to do it anyway. It's time for Dim Bulb of the Week, and we're going to start out with the 2012 Dim Bulb of the Year, who is continuing his proud tradition of utter imbecility.
You know, one of the age-old questions of science is what keeps the nucleus together? Remember, the nucleus consists of a bundle of protons and neutrons. Now, protons have a positive charge. What do positive charges do? They repel each other. What is it that holds the nucleus of the atom together? How does that thing stay together? What holds it together? They've been looking for what scientists call the nuclear glue that keeps them from flying apart. It is Jesus Christ. In him, all things hold together.
Simply breathtaking. And I don't know that I need to say much except that, guys, we're going to need a strong nuclear force to overcome the repellent stupidity of Brian Fisher. But that's not all Brian's been up to lately. He recently went after Megyn Kelly, of all people, who was offended by a guest who maintained that God wants half our population to be ignorant chattels and sperm receptacles.
You talk about a feminist on steroids. That's Megyn Kelly. She is a feminist to the core. She was resentful. She was angry. She was bitter. She was hostile.
Only theocratic authoritarian wingnuts with penises have a God-given right to be angry and bitter.
She was dragon lady going after these men who were simply speaking up for and defending a biblical view. You cannot count, you certainly can't count on Megyn Kelly to defend a biblical view of roles in the home.
You're probably curious about who it was that got Megyn Kelly's panties in a bunch. He's our second nominee.
But I want to turn to a study in the Pew Research showing that women have become the breadwinners in this country, and a lot of other concerning and troubling statistics. Eric, your thoughts on this study and what
well,
it portends?
Lou, I'm so used to liberals telling conservatives that they're anti-science, but I mean, this is liberals who defend this and say it's not a bad thing are very anti-science. When you look at biology, look at the natural world, the roles of a male and a female in society and other animals, the male typically is the dominant role, that the female, it's not antithesis or it's not competing, it's a complementary role.
Now, who could possibly question Eric's assertion? He is entirely correct. The gender roles found throughout the animal kingdom reflect the sensibilities of 1950s white suburban Americans.
It's tearing us apart. What I find interesting in the survey is that 3/4 of the people surveyed recognize that having moms as the primary breadwinner is bad for kids and bad for marriage. And reality shows us that's the truth.
I'm not going to play the entire conversation, of course, but it was fascinating throughout. What was most fascinating to me doesn't touch on gender roles or the question of whether women make more than men and whether that's a good or bad thing. It had to do with the strange attitude that was obvious, and it was shared by Eric Erickson, Lou Dobbs, and Juan Williams, who was also involved, that the level of one's income touches on one's value to society and indeed one's value as a human being. And that's strange in a world where sports stars, who, let's face it, are entertaining but have non-contributive skills, get paid fabulous sums of money, whereas a host of people who are very important, emergency workers, teachers, and so on, get paid squat. Eric Erickson is certainly obnoxious throughout that interview, as are the two other gentlemen involved. But on a given day, nobody can hold a light to Brian Fisher. That said, I do appreciate Brian's continuing effort to demonstrate that no one need take his theology seriously.
Were you born an asshole? Or did you work it in your whole life? Either way, it worked out fine.
Okay, that is Coffee with Claire for today. I must admit that I've been missing you a bit, and I guess I've started missing making these videos on Sunday. So, we may be starting back with this as a weekly series. I can't guarantee it because, well, there are some days I just want to sleep late, and maybe I'm just not in the mood to make a video. But we'll see. So, presumably, we'll be back next week with another coffee. Until then, bis später.